when the Atlanta Chiefs came to Atlanta, they decided the only way they could get to the public is through the children. And the best institution that was already in place, had all its facilities, is guess what? The YMCA. And it started at the Decatur DeKalb YMCA back in 1967. Phil Wooshnam, who was the coach of the Atlanta Chiefs, we had there, they helped us a lot. There was a Dr. Clyde Parton, who was the athletic director at Emory University. And he was very helpful in it. So, and the Atlanta Braves, parents who had kids playing soccer at Decatur DeKalb YMCA. There were no girls, there was not any girls soccer. And I said, we're going to start girls soccer, you know. And so, big mouth here, I became coach of three teams.
Fireball.
When I first got here in 2004, we had a pretty good academy and select program. It was called the Dynamite Soccer Club. We had a soccer director, but then we had a parent board. Also back then, they did not have paid coaches. They had volunteer coaches for academy and select. You had a paid trainer. And the trainer would just train the kids, and the coach would actually coach them on the weekends. So it was way different. Within the first year of me being here, we started moving towards paid coaches.
The academy program that we all know now had literally just started. It was a new thing. So when I came on as one of the first paid coaches. We had two directors within 3 years. I was the third. We lost quite a bit of players in that turnover. I'd say around 1,000 for the 2 years. And then when we started, about 24 kids. So we have a patchwork schedule of three games a weekend. Whole schedule fit on one sheet of paper. Took about 4 months to put together because nobody wanted to play us because we didn't have any teams. We made a pretty conscious decision to really invest in the community. Obviously, we took the hardest possible way to do it, which was probably the most correct way to do it.
When I first got here, Patello was redone the summer of 2004. Long standing, we have been at the United Methodist Children's Home and Columbia Seminary since we started in 68.
First big addition, and what I view as the big turning point for our club, was when we added Boys and Girls Club. And the next big addition was Indian Creek. Finally, we started adding used to Wade Walker Park and then Avondale Dunn Air.
I came on board in June of 2004, Luma Mufla was on our board of directors. She had two refugee soccer teams that were in the rec program, U10 and U12. We all took turns, all the staff took turns driving the bus each weekend to games to pick up the kids. After that first season, they did so well, we started moving them into academy and select. We felt they should be mainstreamed in with the rest of our teams and not keeping them separate. We felt it was a better idea for them to see American children and how they live in America and how, you know, things work. And it's good for the American kids to see all these refugees and to be part of their lives.
For us, she takes us to all the games. She looked out for us. You are special to me because this is where I grew up playing soccer. I learned a lot from them. They taught me how to be a better person. And they always supported me, no matter what. Just want to say thank you to DDY.
Some of my friends were starting a soccer team with Matt and Noop, and so they asked me to play, so I did. Because I feel like it's more than a soccer club, it's like a family, and like I feel like you can only find certain clubs that have that mentality.
We won every championship, every age group, as they went up. It's a ragtag team, and we beat the stew out of everybody we play.
My team that I have now won our end of season tournament, and when I was in U13, we won our preseason.
Teammate Alaji Tombado laid the ball off to me. I placed in the corner. The game was over. And Toby was happy. He held me after the game. Susie was crying.
All I know is we didn't have a place to practice soccer.
We are in need of fields, and obviously the fields and field space.
And this is a constant. There will always be a need of, obviously fields is a priority, not just fields. And I look at that more as a less club-centric kind of issue, as more of a community issue.
They're a little rough, but like when we go to fields that aren't as good, we're able to adapt to it better.
I messed up tonight. I lost another fight. Lost to myself, but I'll just start again. I keep falling down. I keep on
hitting. The good thing about any organization, other people.
The second big thing is that we have lost a lot of parents that drove the program forward in those early years there. And we've lost a lot of that passionate volunteerism from inside the club. So volunteerism and field, I would say those are probably the two biggest things we need. I think what I would tell everyone is, if you really think about our club in a more community, we are a very unique community. And our community is completely different in every way from every other club in Georgia. And I think I'd like to see this community really, quite frankly, stop building apartment complexes and start building green space for these kids.
One of Jeff's teams, when they were younger, like U12, U13, went down to the Savannah tournament. And all the parents kind of adopted each of the refugees that were on the team. And they all took a different refugee with them to stay in their hotel and to feed them for that weekend so they could all go. And the parents were just wonderful. And I just remember one of them, I think it was Eddie, said he had never seen the ocean before in his life, and his family, the Austins, Sandra Austin and her husband, took him out to Tybee Island, and he got to get in the ocean and play in the ocean for the very first time ever, and to see his face after he got back and to talk about that experience was one of the most awesome things ever.
Probably 6 years ago, we had a player, a refugee player, who came over in that first wave of players from the ICS school. And one of the players in there was just an amazing young man. He had big ears and a smile that just kind of, you gravitated to him. And he was a fine player. And over the years, he developed a really close relationship with Toby Uzziah. And one day, Toby was picking him up from practice, which was pretty normal. Wasn't there. And that went on for about 2 weeks. And Toby called me about midnight in a panic and started to have just the worst feelings that something had gone wrong. So this went on for a couple of weeks, and about 2 in the morning, Toby got a phone call from the young man. He was in Philadelphia. His mother had taken his sister and they had fled. The young man was crying. Toby got on a plane the next night, flew to Philadelphia, met with his mom, and Samson moved back to Atlanta and lived with Toby and Rachel for a year. Toby got him back in school, got him counseling, and Samson's going to graduate high school now, back with his family. There's probably 100 more stories just like that. And Toby's that involvement with that young man was when I kind of realized that we had the right people. And we kind of laugh because we always say soccer is the easiest thing we do. And it's the other stuff that takes a moral conscience. It's competitive youth soccer with a conscience. Which is, believe it or not, extremely rare. We all sleep very well at night.
Soccer.
You're a good soldier, choosing your battles. Pick yourself up and dust yourself off and back in the saddle. You're on the front line, everyone's watching. You know it's serious, we're getting closer, this isn't over.